Broadway in all of its glory. We all have a memory. We all have a story.
Was there an understudy? Or did the show stop? Did you see Barbara before she shot to the top?
Join us as we revel in a reverie. It's my Broadway memory.
Hey. Oh, we're shimmying today. Okay. Shimmy.
I have such PTSD from recording. Did you see Barbara before she shot to the top?
Oh, yeah. That was quite tricky to not be in the same room and try and get that rhythm. That perfect rhythm.
She shot to the top.
I couldn't do it right now if you ask. But
it's the new Trouble from Music Man.
When we get into the professional recording studio, we will fix it all.
Hi, Brian.
Hi, Michael. Hello, audience people out there watching. Hi. Welcome to My Broadway Memory.
Welcome. I'm on a little bit of vacation. I'm on Fire Island.
Right. How's that going? Yeah. I forgot.
I got to the island about 3 hours ago. I'm planning on working a lot.
Look at this guy. He is here committed to the show, to keeping this going on his vacation. This is great.
It's just fresh air. I just need some fresh air. I've been out of the city in 4 months. So yeah. I just wanted to, but how's Jersey?
Oh, Jersey's, Jersey. I saw something really positive. We have a very small amount of cases of COVID that are popping up every day, and we're now not letting people into the state from certain other states, which is great.
That's
stay
amazing.
Stay out and if you're sick.
Thing is the Forbes article that came out today saying that protesting is not contributing to the rise.
That was great.
Keep hitting the streets, my friends. Keep just protect yourselves.
But by wearing face masks, that's why they're being contained. Yeah.
Every protest that I've been at, we've had face masks, we've socially distanced, and so I can only speak from experience, and that's awesome. Do you want to get the show started?
Yeah, why don't you introduce our good news correspondent for today?
I absolutely will. What is Deaf Broadway? Filmed in real time via webcam with diverse deaf talent from around the world, this groundbreaking series provides full and complete American Sign Language, ASL, access to beloved selections from the Broadway catalog. Embracing both the challenges and opportunities of our current quarantine, the ultimate goal for Deaf Broadway is unprecedented visual language access for the deaf community. And I am so excited to welcome Garrett Zucker. Yay!
Yes. And of course, his interpreter, Kim.
Yes. Hi, Kim. Hi, Garrett. How are you guys?
Hi.
So, Garrett, do you want to just jump off the diving board? I'm looking at a pool, so I guess that's the imagery I have in my mind, right? I'm literally looking at a pool. Do you want to just explain a little bit about Deaf Broadway, how it started, and anything you want to throw in there?
Sure, absolutely. So my name is Garrett Zucker. I'm deaf. I'm an actor. I'm a director. I'm a playwright. All of those things. I wear many hats. And honestly, the theater community, as we've talked a lot about Broadway being closed, obviously. And, we don't know when it's going to come back, 2021. We have no idea. So it's, in a weird way, this quarantine is also an opportunity for access for the community for Broadway as well. So what happened when coronavirus started, those of us in the deaf community, we were trying to watch shows, Broadway shows. We wanted to watch things on YouTube, Broadway HD. But all of the access was provided how? It was provided with captions. But many people really don't realize that captions are not full access. So, for many reasons, here's a perfect example. Stephen Sondheim's work is famous for being fast and wordy, and there's a lot overlapping. And many people don't see all of that in the captions. Because all of us were deaf actors, we're stuck at home and we had nothing to do. So we thought, why not? Let's watch Sweeney Todd. So let's get a group together and watch on Zoom. And you know the famous film with Angela Lansbury? So we just had a watch party, basically. On Zoom, all of us got together, you know, myself and different deaf actors. And we basically decided, you know, let's get one deaf actor for each character and let's just sign along with the play. And then it became clear for the first time, the captions don't really provide enough information, who the character is, who's saying which line, for example. How are the characters saying it? What is the tone of their voice? Many times two or three or four people are singing at the same time and the captions ignore what the other people are saying, so you don't get the full story. And if you don't believe me, go ahead and watch the captions with Sweeney Todd and you can see for yourself how confusing it is. So basically, we realized that we have plenty of deaf talent around the world and that Zoom is the perfect way to connect our community and allow all of us to work together. Usually, if you have a deaf actor, they don't always get to work with each other because they're spread out all over the United States and everybody's separate. So maybe you see, if you see a show, you might just see one deaf actor and not in one show. You wouldn't see a whole cast of deaf actors, but this really allowed for a whole cast of deaf actors. So we got some friends together to show Sweeney Todd, all deaf friends, and when they saw it, they just loved it. And so many deaf people said, this is the first time I really got it and understood the show. So I was like, we have to keep doing this. It's so important. So then the next show we did was Into the Woods. And we had 20 deaf actors together from all over the world.
Wow.
And for the first time, I understood ASL harmony. It was incredible.
Wow.
Because we had 20 deaf actors who were all signing different things.
Oh my God.
So if you see a show like Spring Awakening and you see that on Broadway, they're all signing the same thing at the same time. So it's more like choreography and it's not really harmony. Harmony really requires that you have different elements that all fit together and make one whole. So to have 20 deaf actors signing different things, it was just beautiful.
So,
but it's funny, when we did Into the Woods, we got a call from Stephen Sondheim's private lawyer. And we were like, oh, I think we're in trouble. So we set up a meeting with MTI, Music Theater International, and they control the rights for most Broadway musicals, and Stephen Sondheim's lawyer. And we got on Zoom, we had the meeting, and the very first thing that they said was, we love what you're doing. And keep doing it. And nothing would make Stephen Sondheim happier than to know that what you're doing is providing access for the deaf community. So we had the full go-ahead. The only problem, really, was that we need a visual tool when we're making these shows because, you know, hearing people, they can hear the music, but deaf actors really need something visual to support and follow while they're performing. So we've been using, you know, filmed musicals primarily that you can see side by side. next to all of the actors performing. And MTI does not control those filmed productions. They only control the performance rights. So they said, go ahead, but you have to get the rights for all of these film performances. And so that's been our biggest challenge so far, is connecting all these individual producers. First, you have to figure out who was the producer, then you have to contact them. Many times it feels like a wild goose chase, honestly. You get sent in all these different directions, sending emails, who has the rights, this person. And anytime we finally get through to the right person, they're like, oh, it's fine. Yeah, go ahead and perform. Yeah. We've contacted MTV, Viacom, Hal Luftig, all of these people, and they're all like, oh, any way we can help you, we'd be happy to.
Wow.
So it's just amazing to see people being so supportive. So far, we've done 4 shows: Sweeney Todd, Into the Woods, Company,
Sondheim Lovers,
and Legally Blonde. Yes, we are Sondheim Lovers, definitely. We've
but
already
also we'd
filmed
love
2 more shows, but we're waiting on permission. Yes, of course. Sondheim is just, he's the best. Everyone loves him. So really, at this point, we're shifting access for captions. I mean, for the deaf community, English captions are their second language.
Mm.
So ASL is their first language. So we really want to provide full access to the shows in their native language.
When theaters come back, what do you see this momentum that you've created? How do you see it moving on and continuing?
Honestly, I don't even know what I'm doing tomorrow. It's impossible right now to predict the future. So we're just taking it day by day for right now. And really, our number one goal is to get permission to provide all kinds of access. For our number one goal right now is to try to provide access for the new release of Hamilton. That is our main goal. So if anyone out there knows Lin-Manuel Miranda and can help us get permission, we would really appreciate it.
I mean, just put it out there, you know? And that was kind of going to be one of my questions is, since you're feeling a little overwhelmed and not sure what's going to happen next, Shakina, just who's our guest for tonight, just wrote in the backstage chat, just said she's feeding him now. But I, you know, since Good News is a call to arms, how can we get involved? How can we help out Deaf Broadway? I mean, Brian and I, the listeners, the viewers, how can we get involved with you and help you?
You can follow us on Instagram. You can follow us on Facebook, social media. Anytime you post something, just retweet, repost, just get the word out there that we're Deaf Broadway on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, everything. So you can follow us and see our work. That would really be the best thing you could do.
Yeah, we'll be sure to put that in our story later on tonight and in the show notes.
100%. When you're talking about harm, just a quick question, there's such a layered idea of what harmony is when the sound is actually taken out. So, you know, I'm thinking of songs like Sondheim has a lot of counterpoint, and I'm thinking of other songs that have counterpoint, like One Day More in Les Mis, and thinking of the character's intention in those shows.
Your Fault is probably a nightmare in Into the Woods.
My God, Your Fault. Like what that is like to discuss that when the language.
You have
language,
no idea.
Oh my God.
It's It's so funny. During our rehearsal, we rehearse each show maybe two times before.
Wow.
And it's funny, we're all deaf actors, and we were just completely lost during Your Fault, because most of the time, the individual lines were not captioned in that part of the show. So they're like, when do I jump in? When do I overlap? What do I do? So I directed that show, so I just told the actors, basically, I said, don't worry about the timing. Just have the script ready next to you and just sign and get those lines out as much as possible. And don't worry about timing, because we tend to worry about, you know, for ASL, the message, just get the lines out, because the message is what really is important. I will say we did have to add a lot of cues for the deaf actors as well, so they would know when to start. It was a real challenge because of the complicated score. And then we had to add character names to all of the lines in this actual video because they weren't there, because the actors had no idea who was saying what line. So really, so far, you know, we've done a lot of captions. Oh, sorry, with the deaf community and captions, it feels like you're just feeding us a little bit. But we don't actually get to experience these shows the way they were meant to experience, the way they were written, because the captions don't provide enough.
Well, I think it's really great to bring that sort of awareness to everybody, because, you know, something that, you know, Michael and I would have thought about, like harmony, you know, I would have never thought that harmony doesn't come across in the same way as it does to us. You know, you just think it's about not being able to hear, but that there are those intricacies that are more important than just the words themselves.
And what makes it even better, about 90% of deaf children are born hearing parents. And that 90%, most of their parents never even learn sign. So these deaf children are stuck at home with no language access. They can't communicate with their families. And we've heard from so many people who've reached out to us and saying, thank you for creating this for my children. Thank you for giving my kids a language model, because they're not getting anything right now being stuck at home during coronavirus.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing?
One mother specifically said to us, my hearing kids love the movie Into the Woods, but it wasn't until now that my deaf child could actually enjoy it with them.
Wow.
And that is absolutely amazing, because that is another way that musical theater proves to bring people and families together. Musical theater is a way for people to come out, to express themselves, to be able to get their wildest dreams realized. But this is about communication. This is about understanding humans on another level. And this just proves that musical theater is the best. is the healing, is the
amen.
Yeah. Thank you so much, my friends, for coming on. Kim and Garrett, both of you, thank you. We will get this little section of the show out on our social media so everyone can see. And I'm feeling very inspired by this, and Brian, are you as well?
100%.
We'll be in touch, and we'll, and yes, and what are your socials, Garrett? So we can, keep in touch and tweet you out and all that good stuff.
At Deaf Broadway.
Cool.
On all the platforms.
All across the board.
Awesome.
Cool. Love it. Thank you. Joey Caverly wants to know, can Deaf Broadway do Hairspray next?
Wow.
Hopefully. Oh, because of what's happening with Black Lives Matter, we really want to shift the focus to more shows that really feature people of color. So those are the next shows that we're working on. So because people in the deaf community, deaf people of color, don't get enough access, don't have enough exposure. So we really want to show, take this opportunity to show people of color and deaf talent.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Amazing. Thank you guys so much. Really.
We're going to start you from the rooftops with your socials and make sure that people get involved. So thank you so much for being here today.
See you guys.
Yay!
Bye. Bye, friends. Oh, that was amazing.
Yeah, that was really great.
That was, you know, that just proves that musical theater is always able to, it's not just about entertainment. It's not just fluff. It's not just smiles. It's not just glitter. It is ways of communication. It is ways of connecting people.
Yeah.
And just when we think that we figure it out, there's another way for it to connect. And I think that's a really good segue to bring on our next guests.
You introduce the first one?
Talking about connection, right? I'll never forget when I first met Shakina Nayfack, one of our two guests today. It was 2003. I was working at Barrington Stage Company, and I think right then and there, I was like, I just want to be her. I saw her and was like, I just want to be her. And her presence is otherworldly, and she is an artist of the highest degree. We know her from Difficult People as Lola the waitress, and most recently Transparent, the musical finale. But I know her from her incredible one-woman shows that has been at Joe's Pub and traveled the US, and she'll talk more about that. And I just know her as an incredible artist, especially as the founding artistic director of Musical Theater Factory. And I'm really excited to welcome Shakina Nayfack.
Yes.
Hi.
And we have, who do we have joining her tonight? We have Eve Lindley, who's an actress and model. And I think they're both very excited to hang out with each other, they've told us. She's best known for her roles in Dispatches from Elsewhere and All We Had. And in 2016, she was named in Out Magazine's Out 100. So let's bring on Eve.
Hi.
Bring on.
How's it going? Okay. Hi, Eve.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh my gosh!
Thank
absolutely.
You so much. I'm obsessed what is that called? It's not a mannequin.
The dress form.
With a beautiful crown on it.
Yeah.
Eve can do everything, y'all. Eve could do everything. She's the perfect person to have by your side of the apocalypse. She can make you an outfit, she can do your hair, she can style your wig, she can,
you know. Yeah, thank you for saying that. That means a lot to me.
You can do everything. Between the two of you, the world would, if we were all wiped out, between the two, and the two of you were to survive, the world would be just fine because you could do everything and anything.
That actually, they would at least be great shows.
Yes,
that really tracks. We are together the perfect person.
Yes, Shakina, Eve, how did you both meet? How did you guys become friends?
We met, this is one of my favorite stories actually, because we met at a trans Hollywood panel conversation at the center here in New York, like years and years and years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't become friends then. We just met each other. But I love this story because when I was introduced to Eve by someone else who was trying to make all these connections between the trans people who were there, because there were a few of us, only a few. And someone was like, oh yeah, you gotta have to meet. And they brought us over. And I don't know what, how it happened, but Eve said to me, I'm in a really good place right now. Her movie was coming out, and I was like, Eve's in a really good place. I just think about that when I think about Eve.
Yeah, well,
I really wanted
to tell you that I was in a really good place. I thought you would be happy to know that.
I've never stopped being happy about that, Eve. I've been happy about that for 5 years.
Thank you. You're in a really good place. I'm happy about that.
Thank you.
Yes. Where do we even begin? I feel like there's so much to talk about. Shakina, we have Musical Theater Factory, which is something that we worked on so deeply together. And I don't know if you want to. Yeah, you take it. You talk about MTF and
sure.
Because that's such a brilliant representation of your core, your soul.
Yeah. Well, I didn't go to theater camp. I went to Jewish camp and did theater. So I felt I still had more gritty magic to make, I suppose. And maybe 6 years ago, I had a friend who owned this gay porn studio in the middle of Times Square, basically. And he was giving up the lease on the place and asked if I wanted to build something in the back room. And I was like, well, of course I'm going to build a black box theater and devote it entirely to the development of new musicals. So I was also crowdfunding my transition during that time. And so I just chose the name MTF, Musical Theater Factory, because it was sort of a way for me to put everything together, my journey and this new project. And and then it just kind of exploded. A bunch of people came and helped build it. And then we used to joke, when we were painting the floor of this old porn studio, we'd be one day, the next Pulitzer Prize winning musical is going to be written here. And it was. So that's amazing. You know, Michael R. Jackson's A Strange Loop, came through our studio, which is so many incredible shows, so many incredible artists. There are relationships that have been formed. There are relationships that have broken. There are lots of things that whole creative projects, worlds birthed, through what MTF has done. And now it exists primarily as an organization that supports artists of color and trans and gender nonconforming artists to get their ideas from initial concept to first full draft or first concert or, something to where the work is shareable and it gets there through a process of collaboration and peer evaluation and, it's kind of magical. I have very little to do with it now. Man Tio is the new artistic director, and I'm just happy that it exists.
Yeah.
Some of my favorite memories in the city are with you and that organization and, just sweating, drinking whiskey, listening to Joy Conis, iconic nights. This is it. And it was.
Yeah. I think that amazing. Everyone who comes through New York has that iconic place and time experience, and I'm glad that I was able to create one for so many people because it's iconic in the way that theater in New York can be iconic. And I'm part of a lineage, the Zipper Factory and Le Poisson Rouge. I mean, there's just so many, we were one place. But we did it in a cool way. We still do it in a cool way.
What do you guys say we get started on some Broadway memories and get into the whole Playbill thing?
Oh, yeah, that's what we're here.
So I'm going to get I'll show you guys how the gig works. Get my – this is one of my binders. And Michael and I have these. Michael, did you bring them to Fire Island with you? You brought one.
I brought a select few, but I pre-picked mine tonight because it's a very – very short, very specific story.
Very good.
Yeah, that's all.
All right, so I got one of my binders here. You guys tell me when to stop.
Ooh.
Stop.
Ooh. Oh.
Yeah.
No, well, that's fine. No, go back.
Yeah.
Go back one.
No.
Go back one. Sure.
Yeah.
Go back one?
I think, hand to God.
No.
Okay.
Wow. Leave, do you have a preference?
Wow.
I don't know either one of those shows.
I want you to do Fun Home because this is our last Pride episode of.
Oh, do Fun Home. Fun Home's so
good. Sure.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Everyone's got a Fun Home memory.
All right, let's pull it out. Here we go. All right.
Everyone has a fondle memory.
So I got my ticket stub in here. I remember it was Mother's Day of 2015. We won the digital lottery on Today Ticks, and I think it was like the first time I ever won one of those digital lotteries, and so I went with my mom, and we got sat in the front row of Circle in the Square, and let's see, $32, that's a good price. I have to say, this is the second week in a row, Michael, I'm so sorry, I was not a fan of this show. Last week, I didn't like what I chose last week either. I'm sorry. But I don't know if it's also because of where I sat. You know, front row for that show wasn't so good. It was all the way. It was a little obstructed because of the way that Circle in the Square was situated for that one. It wasn't the round. Let's pull up the title page.
What is Fun Home about?
It's about a family who... owns a funeral home, and that's the fun home. And it's this girl who discovers her sexuality at the same time as her father's dealing with his sexuality, I believe. These are the headshots.
And then that's just like tearing everyone's hearts open.
Yeah.
Oh my God, look at this headshot we love.
Everybody was really good. I mean, Sydney Lucas was phenomenal. I mean, I think that was like right after she got her Tony nomination at like, I don't know, she was probably like 10. And
at 10 years old, Cranston and Footloose, so that's good. Chuck Cranston is the one that thinks the girl gets around, so that's good.
Let's see, we've got ads for On the Town, which was on the same time.
On the Town.
It Should Have Been You, another prideful show.
I loved that show. I had such a
fun.
And at the same time, let's see what was playing. At the same time, we had A Gentleman's Guide to Love and Murder, Aladdin, Airline Highway, An Act of God, Beautiful, Hand to God, Hedwig. Loved Hedwig. That's a good story that I should have done today, but it has a pride memory. It Should Have Been You, On the Town, Matilda, Mamma Mia, lots of good stuff. Did anybody see, any of you guys see the show?
I saw it twice.
I actually saw it three times.
I think I saw it twice too. I took my mom also.
Perfect.
I saw it three times. I saw it once with the public and twice on Broadway.
Oh, wow.
I was going to ask if it went through the public.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it won the Tony, right, that year?
It did.
Yeah.
I loved it. Shakina, I think you were going to say something in the middle of that. I think when It Should Have Been You, the ad for It Should Have Been You popped up.
Oh, I don't know. I just said Lisa Howard, but was she? I might be thinking of the different thing. But was that?
No,
Lisa
she was
Howard,
in like, yeah.
Star Vehicle.
Yeah, I think she got a Tony nom, right?
It was a Lisa Howard. Yeah, it was a Lisa Howard. Well, it was. She had a great number in it and wailed herself to a Tony nom. You know,
she's iconic.
It was similar to like Jen Samard in Disaster.
Mm-hmm.
It was like that, like standout performance. Right, and I loved Disaster because I love spoofs. I loved Disaster, and I loved It Should Have Been You. And both of those shows didn't really get much attention, in a lot of different aspects. But those two performances, Jen Samard in Disaster was,
ridiculous.
And Lisa was amazing as well. And I liked that. That was good.
Yeah. Eve or Shakina, which one of you guys wants to go first?
Eve.
Oh. Okay.
A lot of our guests actually
volunteer the other. So that.
Okay. So I've narrowed it down to four.
All right.
Should I show you what they are or should I just like shuffle them and find one?
Do you shuffle? I just saw one that I really hope you land on, but like if you don't, that's okay.
Yeah. Okay, I'm just gonna show them all to you then.
Yeah, okay. Let's see. Legally Blonde.
And then you can sort of decide which one
Okay.
Okay.
I think I know.
Michael knows which one I would pick.
Yes. And I think I know which one Shakina would pick.
I don't know. Maybe. What do you think I would pick, Michael?
I think it would be the... I know Brian would want this one, but I feel like it would be the third one, the second one in from the left.
Wait, so
you can just say it, because I can see them now.
It would be the apple tree one.
The apple tree one.
Yeah, totally. I'm so intrigued by your memory about the apple tree.
That was what I was going to choose. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's signed.
We did a stage door.
Yes, we did a full stage door.
Okay, I know what I'm sharing today. Next then.
Okay, apple tree. You'll note the beautiful text choice that they went with. There's like a little snakey snake there. And I think it's a really chic playbill for a show that is featuring a diva, like an iconic diva.
We love.
Signed by Brian Darcy James of Smash fame and Kristen Chenoweth of Pushing Daisies fame.
Or Wicked. Anything.
Or literally anything before Pushing Daisies. There's actually an article about the show in the Playbill, which I always think is like a...
Look at that. She's just beautiful. Look at
that. She's stunning. She's absolutely
so beautiful.
She doesn't
age either, so... There's
my God, never. And then there she is, the other third character. It's like a series of one acts. So she plays like all these different characters, which I thought was super cool and iconic.
What month was this?
Where would I find the month?
In like the second or third page usually?
January 2007.
Nice.
Which means it was my first birthday in high school. I was a freshman in high school. And it was my birthday. And... I don't know if anybody, Sean Palmer's in it. I feel like he's in a bunch of stuff. I feel like I know that name.
Sean Palmer, I think was Prince Eric in Mermaid.
Yes. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
The one that, and her voice and with Prince Eric.
It's gotta be really hard to be Kristen Chenoweth's understudy in this.
And that was that roundabout, I believe.
In general, I think that's gotta be hard.
I know.
Yeah. Who it was Roundabout Theater Company, Studio 54, which I also thought was really cool and iconic when I went there. I was like,
did you see it on a Hiptics?
No. I like begged my parents to take me to this because.
Why? Because of Kristen?
Because of Kristen. I really liked Kristen. And fun fact, this show got me really obsessed with the first act of this show is the like Adam and Eve story, and it got me really obsessed with the story and the snake and the apple and all this stuff, and I did all this research and how it was a pomegranate and a fig, and like part of why I chose the name Eve came from this friggin' Broadway show, I think. Which is crazy. Yeah. And I met Kristen Chenoweth afterwards and was super shy and nervous. And that was, oh my God.
Oh my gosh.
I did not see the apple tree, but I'm a huge fan of Kristen's. And my bedroom in high school was like Kristen Chenoweth all over it.
That's fabulous. She was amazing in this. She really was.
Yeah, I love that it's such a huge part of your identity, this show. That's amazing.
I know. I mean, I think that like indirectly, because then I was in the show actually, and I played Adam. And
you don't
Adam
see it being done often.
No. Again, I begged for it to be done at this like performing arts place. And I played Adam, and Adam sings a song that is just called Eve. And it's like about all the things that Eve does and how wild and cuckoo crazy she is. So I was like, that's me.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
And talk about the stage door experience, since that's a part of it.
Oh my God. It was, I'm never really at a loss.
You know, you really got it when you got her full signature instead of just Casey.
Yeah, I got a full... I have a photo of me getting the signature, too, which I don't know where it is. But my parents were like, go take a picture. And I, like, wasn't saying anything. I just was like, signed my thing. And she
I think
was
that
like,
was like the first time I stage doored for her. Promises, promises. And I literally couldn't say a word. Yeah. Just like, you know, when you just meet somebody that you've looked up to for so long and it's just like, you want to tell them how meaningful they are to you, especially like as a middle schooler.
Yeah, exactly.
And you just, and you're like, they're in front of me. And
literally you're this big.
Like I'm in eighth grade and I'm taller than you.
I'm like towering over her and I can't say anything to her.
I love
she was truly incredible. I couldn't believe she didn't get every award for this. It was so good.
I like don't, I want to find that bootleg because I want to see her sing Gorgeous.
Me too.
I don't know. There
used to be on YouTube a bootleg in parts of the very first, like they did it with scripts as like a roundabout thing. And it's not with Brian D'Arcy James.
Who it is.
But it's with another guy. And then that's really cool to watch. But yeah. And so the original part was played by Barbara Eden, who's also really fabulous. And there's footage of her doing it also.
That Tony performance is pretty unbelievable.
It is.
She That's has a quick change.
Yeah. Oh, I'm going to have to YouTube that.
Me too.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Barbara Eden. Wait, Barbara Eden's, what? Is that what I'm going to look up on YouTube?
Yeah, Barbara Eden, Gorgeous Live or something.
Gorgeous.
Yeah, Tony, okay.
Oh my God. It's a Tony performance. It's amazing. Eve, thank you.
Shakina, what do you have for us?
I mean, I also pulled a stack.
Yeah.
So I can show some. I already pulled some out. I brought Jekyll and Hyde in Plastic Hair. Line the Piazza, Testament of Mary, The Normal Heart, and Masterclass with Patti LuPone. So I could go any direction.
It's Patti's sure. Masterclass.
There you go.
Patti. Okay.
You got to do that one because
you know
that's one of the shows that I would have to go back in time and see.
Okay.
This is
Patti LuPone.
This isn't Patti LuPone's Masterclass, right?
No.
But I'm sure it was.
This is Maria Callas Masterclass. Yeah, this is Patti LuPone in it. In Terrence Malick's Masterclass. On the second or third page, I should see the month and year. Where should that be?
Yeah, it should be like first or second page. Let's say on like the top left of
this is December 1996. Wow. So I had just turned 16.
I don't want to tell you how old I was.
Yeah. I was on. Yeah, it's all right. My boyfriend was one, so it's okay.
I was 3 months old.
I was. Yeah. I was. I was on a school field. We're not too done. We moved on. I was on a school field trip. I think it was my sophomore year of high school. and I was on a school field trip and it was one of those like the drama club trip where you would go and see like six shows in 5 days. And it was like over the Christmas to New Year's time. That's so it was like packed and crazy. And I did, expensive. I did Times Square. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was like you paid the drama club fee and then everything was, you know, taken care of whatever. But so we got all these shows and one of the shows we went to see was Patti LuPone and Masterclass. And of course, like I didn't know that she wasn't going to sing, you know, I was like, I'm going to see Patti LuPone in Masterclass. I'm going to just get like a Patti LuPone concert. And no, she just gets up there and she's actually like, I will not sing today. And then, you know, the whole play is about her being a badass teacher for these other actors, students. So anyway, what can we find in here? There is a theater quiz.
Let's see her headshot too.
Oh, wait, let's see her headshot. Let's start there. Yeah.
Was her understudy?
No. The role of Sharon was now being played by Elaine Rodine Lowe. But this is the title page. That's an ad. Oh. This is the title page.
I wish they would do more photography in a playbill about the show you're going to see. You know?
I know, right? Like, yeah. But they only do that in like the souvenir program. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And then here's what we, because so like basically the program was like as if you were actually going to a Maria Callas masterclass.
Cool.
And then the actor.
Yeah, I love that.
The actor playing the character that you would be seeing, and you, and then there would be these incredible moments of music filling the theater. But I don't see. Is it possible that? Okay, here we go.
Oh, okay. Oh,
wait, coming in.
Wow. Wow, yes. Look at the turtleneck.
Oh, it,
yeah.
Fierce. I wonder if that's turtleneck. The same headshot she used in Gypsy. I'm going to check. Because
I'm sure it is. What else is in here that's interesting? Let's see what else was going on this time. I like to go see, like, wait, they don't even have that. Have you seen them all?
They don't have it at the back?
Headshot at all.
No, I love that. That's my favorite thing of, like, what else was playing at the time. Maybe there's Celebrity Choice.
It's not in there.
I don't know. No.
No, it's gotta be. It's gotta be. No, it's back further, right?
Oh, it's sort of in the middle. Here we go.
It's in the middle.
Look, it's here in the Playbill.
That's weird.
But there's this much after of like ads and such.
Wow.
Wow.
So here's what's going on. We have can you see anything?
A funny thing
happened on the way to the forum. I saw that.
Oh my god.
Candide, An Ideal Husband. I can't read.
Beauty and the Beast. Chicago.
I saw that when I was there. Greece.
Oh, that's
on the bottom.
Yeah, that was Chicago. God, must be at the Schubert.
The Greece with Rosie O'Donnell.
It was the Greece with Rosie O'Donnell. I didn't see it.
And
I saw
Shields.
Forum, nice. Chicago. Once Upon a Mattress was playing then. Rent was still playing, of course.
SJP, Once Upon a Mattress.
I guess the original Miss Saigon was still playing.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah. And Sunset Boulevard.
Wow.
And Phantom, of course. Yeah.
Wow.
Let's see what was off Broadway. Blue Man Group. Forbidden Broadway.
Blue Man
Group.
Well, Audra McDonald won a Tony for this production, but I don't know if you saw. I don't know if you saw
a masterclass.
I think I was. I was. GM. No, I was. This was already the Tonys had already happened in the. You know, in the fall.
So Patty was a replacement. Like they replaced a star with a star.
No, Audra. So in the show, she.
Oh, it's, there's many
Palace
roles.
Maria Callas is giving a masterclass.
Yeah,
and
she's giving a masterclass.
Student take. She's giving class, but the original Maria Callas is Zoe Caldwell. Zoe Caldwell.
Right. Right.
And that was in the production. That was, I think, Patty replaced her. Oh God, I don't know. Yes, Zoe Caldwell opened this production.
Oh my God.
When they put cigarette ads in.
Gross.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Look how
what was that? Is that a cigarette
ad? It was a cigarette ad. Yeah.
They're not happy now. I mean,
no.
Yeah. We should catch up with them. I bet they're not doing
Oh, and
well.
The Madonna Evita.
Oh, that's pretty.
Was coming out.
Patty, let that be printed in her Playbill.
Shocking, right?
Yeah.
That's funny. That's comedy.
That's real comedy.
Can I show you something else that I brought?
Because
I just thought it was funny. Yes, so this is my Playbill for Jekyll and Hyde that I have a few that are in plastic. I guess when I was a teenager, I was like, oh, but most of them aren't. And it's autographed by Kate Schindel, which is amazing because she's like the president of the union. And I know that I staged door and we talked like a half hour because at the time she was doing a lot of like volunteer work in like local prisons doing like theater education. And I was so blown away by that because I was in college studying theater and social change. And like, here was this Broadway star who was like Miss America and then a Broadway star and still managed to do like really great humanitarian work. But the thing that I love the most about this program is that the other program here is a fully autographed Squonk. And I don't even know what the fuck Squonk
what
is. I don't know what that is.
You don't know, but you saw it.
What is Squonk?
I saw it and clearly like waited around long enough to like meet everybody and get autographs. I'm going to open it.
Put it on eBay.
They're all dead name.
They're all like dead name autographs. They're like, hey, you. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Just, you know what I'm saying?
So who are these people? Who is that? Where was it? First of all.
Okay. Let's look at the Helen Hayes.
Oh, it was on Broadway.
Love that theater.
Check this out. You open it That's the first page. It's the Playbill again.
No, no, no.
Why is that?
No, that's
why is that?
That's wrong.
That's a mistake.
Wait. Is this what's the next page?
So, well, maybe this whole thing is fake and it didn't even happen. Let's look. So then
you definitely got like a misprint. Because I did, that but first cool. ad, that's really cool.
It was a misprint.
That's like getting a coin with like a misprint on the coin.
The Making of Aida is the first article. The Making of Aida. And then I don't know. Let's see. Making of Aida, the story of Making of Aida.
Justice
and then
Aida.
Moonstruck. I guess were they were trying to do Moonstruck again or something? I don't know. And then Squonk, created by Steve O'Hearn and Jackie Dempsey. Squonk! I don't know a single, I don't know a name. Puppets, it's clearly puppets, it says that. But yeah, I don't
Somebody
know.
Somebody worked really hard on Squonk, I bet.
Look at, here are some scenes from it.
It was a Squonker.
Mm.
Oh.
Scenes from Squonk.
It ran on Broadway for...
Now I remember.
It ran on Broadway for 32 performances.
For how many?
35? 32 performances.
32, and 32. I saw one. I am 1/32nd.
And those were probably all previews.
Yeah, I dropped the ticket. Hold on.
You're 1/32.
Wow.
Squonk kills me.
I even have like
how
a
How much was your ticket?
Oh, no, it's not a ticket. It's just like a business card.
Oh, okay.
Like a, for adverts.
Always
I know,
interested
I wish.
In those olden days ticket sales.
Yeah, I think it was a clown piece. I think it was like Italian clown piecing because it, then it has some, like it has a libretto in the script too.
It's what? Pretty niche.
Yeah, right? Italian clowns. That's you a know. Thing. That's a big thing.
Yeah. Italian Commedia. Clowning.
Commedia, as it's called.
Commedia.
Yep.
Our producer, Alan, says that it opened February 29th, did 24 previews, and then 32 performances.
Damn.
Listen, that's...
Better than
that's
Carrie, funny. Right?
Yeah, I was going to ask, is that more
More times
Carrie?
Than I've been on Broadway, so I'm not going to knock it.
How many did Carrie
did you
run
on Broadway?
Opening and closing, right? Did it open and close?
Yeah,
no, that was,
I think it'd have been...
It's like 2 days after
the intermission. The post closing at the intermission of the first performance of opening night.
Really?
Didn't they post? I think this lore is that they posted closing on. We have to ask Jennifer Ashley Tepper because no one else
she would know. Yeah, she would know.
I wish I got to see the revival of that.
I know, me too. At the where was that? That was
Lucille Lortel.
Lortel. Yeah.
For a second,
there's
I thought
a really
you meant
good
revival
bootleg of it.
Yes, I think
the
I've seen it.
Squonk.
I think I've seen it. Michael, do you have a memory that you're sharing tonight?
You betcha. It had 5 performances on Broadway. It closed. Carrie opened on May 12th and closed on May 15th.
Okay. They said
so they
finish
probably
the week.
Posted.
Wow.
They said finish the week. We'll give you a week. So this is the Playbill that I picked today.
Allegiance.
And it was the first, it was the, I guess it was the second Broadway show I worked on because I did the, you know, Shakina at Barrington, I did the out of town tryout of On the Town, but didn't, you know, whatever. But then I assisted on the key art photo shoot for this with Matt Murphy in 2000, like beginning of 2014. End of 2013, beginning of 14, right when I moved to the city. And it was amazing because that was when I met Telly and Leah Salonga and Katie Rose Clark. And it was just amazing. Mm-hmm. And it was also the first show that I received press seats to because I had worked on the show.
Oh, so special.
Yes.
Look at that premium ticket.
Right, exactly. But I was like, I'm going to celebrate, and before the show, I'm going to go to Buffalo Wild Wings across the street because it was at the Long Acre, and I'm going to have a few beers. And I had beers, and all of a sudden, within 15 minutes of the show, I was like, oh, you got to pee at intermission.
Oh,
you got to really pee at intermission. And about 15 minutes later, the pain that I had experienced in that moment of not being able to pee. And I was in the middle of row, I think H, and I had never done this before, but I got up in the middle of the show and I fully was like, excuse me. Ran out and I felt so bad because I had never ever done that before. And I was
bad theater goer.
I don't think I've ever done it. I think if I did it, I would just leave. I wouldn't.
But we're not shaming you, Michael. But we're not shaming you.
Did you come back and sit down?
Of course I did. I'm not missing the fucking show.
Especially
I would have at least like waited in the back until intermission.
I don't know. I feel like
only because I'm so large. I'm like a giant creature. And so I'm so self-conscious about those sort of like, I feel like, Michael, you could move like deftly in darkness, but I can't.
It's not in darkness. That's a show title.
Definitely, that's going to last on Broadway for a week. At least it was on Broadway. I really liked that show and it was really cool to work on. And that was a funny memory. I always, you know, remember that. But do you guys want to play games?
Okay,
we got a game.
Wait, Ellen just gave us facts. Ellen said Glory Days open and closed 2008. Known as Glory Day. Take Me Along open April 14th, 85. Dance a Little Closer opened and closed May 11th, 83. Cleavage opened and closed June 23rd, 82. Play Me a Country Song was just Cleavage, just June 27th, 82.
These are like the top.
Oh my God. These are. No, I think he said that there's 22 Broadway shows that open and close on the same night. And those are all of them.
Wow.
Right. And Play Me.
And then the latest one. What's the latest one? Probably Lestat.
Lestat.
Glory Days, right?
Glory Days.
Let's try.
Oh, Glory Days.
Yeah.
Broadway's Dick Blamire. Hey.
Yeah. Nick Blamire.
Listen, you get all the way, you get your show open on Broadway, you made it. You're somebody, you know, like Dana Morales says. Like you're there. And
honestly,
so if it lasts one day, you got one day. You know, I've been on Broadway for 7 minutes. So
yes.
At the end of Hair?
That was me.
Yeah. No, that was me.
Me too. No, I did like the Red Bucket Follies and 24-Hour Plays. So I've done BCEFA and special events and stuff.
Wait, hold on. Another time I went up on stage was Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, where they brought six people up to
open act
two. That was pretty cool. Yeah.
That counts.
Well, what's amazing, Brian and Shakina, is that the episode when we had Josh Lehman on and Brian was obsessing over Hair. He was at the closing and Brian described a woman in a big floppy hat and sundress. Was that what it was?
That was me.
And a sundress.
That is a sundress. Okay, and that, Josh Lehman was like, I'm so glad you remembered to say that because
Josh said that was me or what happened? That is
Josh
crazy.
Said that
what?
That was you. So yeah. I was, that was my Broadway memory when we had Josh on and he was like, oh no, that was Shakina. He's like, I know exactly who that woman was.
You wore a hat to a Broadway show?
No. I don't know if it was a hat.
It was closing night of Hair.
You were not wearing a big
hat. I don't know if you remember, but it was on Pride Day that year.
Of course.
Oh. And it was a crazy experience I was 13.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
I called that my summer of the sundress. I came to New York and all I wanted to do was wear sundresses at Broadway shows. And so I did.
I can't believe I found the woman who was wearing a sundress.
So that was your memory is that you just remembered a woman wearing a sundress?
No. I was just giving my visuals for that. Uh-huh. Let the Sun Shine. And that was it. Yeah.
The flesh failures when, one of the times, not closing night, but I was sitting in the front row and Vanessa Ray reached down and grabbed my hands and I didn't know her then, but she's sang to me how dare they try to end this beauty, and we were holding hands and I was so high because I had smoked a joint in their mission and then was weeping and just holding Vanessa Ray's hands, and then she lifted me up and lifted my hands up and I could just feel the spirit move through me. It was the most amazing thing. It was everything I wanted theater to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
stunning.
We need that show again.
Yeah.
in these so crazy times. Yeah.
That would be a good show to open up the, open everything up again.
Yeah. We have, I think I shared my screen. So Alan, if we can get that on the screen, we'll play a game called Call for Line. And so I described it a little bit before we started, but it's like a lyric game. So here's an example. Memory all alone in the blank.
Easy.
All alone in the what?
In the blank.
Do we,
in the moonlight.
Do we shout it out, or are we supposed to shout it out?
No, that's your example. So
okay.
This is our first lyric. So who wants to do this? Who wants to start? Okay.
Until I'm legally wed.
Okay. Shakina. There we go. Eve.
Oh no. Okay. I was looking at, but heaven knows anything goes.
Close.
God knows.
God knows. Oh shit.
That was good. We'll still give you a point.
I was really close.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So raise your right finger.
It does help if you sing.
Right, okay. Well, I don't care. I don't know. I'm just thinking
about it. Yeah.
Okay.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Oh shit. Why do I have all the ones I don't know?
Just like the weird obscure poetic ones.
I will sing the
song. Do you know what it's from?
Hold on. What is this from?
Spring Awakening.
Okay. All shall know.
It does help if you sing, but not like you can sing in your head.
I just don't know. I don't know the song.
I don't know it either. I think it's like
Golden Slumber.
That's close.
The wonder.
Wonder.
See
the line where the sky meets the sea blank, and no one knows how far it goes blank.
Is this Little Women?
This is Moana.
This is Moana, bitch.
Oh.
Eve knows this one.
Yes, I do.
See the line with the sky and the sea. Da, da, da. No one knows how far it goes. Da, da, da. I don't know.
It calls me. There was an extra added line.
I was looking for a rhyme scheme. I was like, no, then the line ends.
Yeah. That's a typo.
It calls me. Okay, good. Mm-hmm.
So many men seem destined to settle for something small, but I won't miss. What is this from?
I think it's from Pippin.
Pippin, yep.
It's from Pippin. Okay. I don't know Pippin. So many men seem destined to settle for something small. I won't rest. So,
I was just like, we should start a rumor that Pippin's transphobic. We should just say that. Pippin's transphobic.
Yeah. Pippin.
There you go.
I just skip that. You know what? This is what I was going to say. Yeah, that's what I thought.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Oh.
Super voice, invisible girl, son of steel and daughter of air. Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That song is low-key about being trans. Just saying.
It is not a duet. It is a solo about being trans.
It's a solo one sings with oneself. Yeah.
I'm obsessed with that.
Eve, this is you. When it's done.
I can smile.
I don't know.
It's on someone else's plate for a while.
Yes. Waitress. What Baking Can Do.
It's actually the best song in Waitress that everyone forgets about.
No, I would 100% agree with you on that, Eve. It is the song.
Yeah. I don't know. It's so much better than Your Girl.
Used to be mine. Yeah.
The Girl That Used to Be Mine or whatever. Yeah.
This is it.
I don't know this, but I know. I don't know.
I'm trying to iron out my creases. I'm a bunch of broken pieces. It was you who... Does it rhyme with pieces and creases? Are we?
Do you know what this is from?
I have no idea.
It's Beetlejuice.
Oh man.
He's like, hell no.
Soon. Yeah. I don't know.
Do you know this one? You want to steal it?
No. I don't know Beetlejuice.
Made me whole.
It was you who made me whole.
Oh.
And last one for Eve.
Wait, what's your rush? What's your hurry? You gave me such a fright. I thought you was a ghost. Half a minute.
Yes.
Yes.
That's it.
Good job, friend.
Yay.
You guys did great. Fun.
It was fun.
It was really fun. I did not
do that. Everybody!
Hello.
Hello. Hello! Oh my god!
Hi!
Hi. Oh my gosh!
Josh is back.
For you.
Hi, Shakina. Hi, Shakina.
We were just talking about this.
I know you were, and I think about you all the time. I think about meeting you all the time. And especially during all of this, I've been thinking about you all the time. And I wish we were doing the show now. I wish you were in it with me, because back then we were doing it when life was la-la, Obama, la-la-la. Everything right. was la-la and Lily and love-love. And now it's what it was. It was anger, because the show was written out of anger. And hi, Eve.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm magical. I am. I'm a miracle. I can tell. No, but I'm good. Thanks. And hi, Brian. Hi, Brian.
Hello.
Hey, Brian.
Hey, Josh.
Hi. Hi, Michael. Happy almost birthday.
Yeah.
Happy almost birthday. When's your birthday?
July 10th, Cancer.
July 10th, Cancer. The stars kissed the moon and Michael Kushner was born.
Oh, yeah, they did.
The world was forever changed.
Josh, you always wear really fun shirts. What's on your shirt tonight?
Today, it's a flower of some sort, different colors. It made me feel like I didn't look like Meatloaf, like old Meatloaf. Not the singer, just like Meatloaf. That you didn't finish eating because it tasted like disappointment, but you weren't going to do seamless because you promised your cats and your therapist you wouldn't. And your financial person, you know, invisible or real.
Yeah.
Amen.
Josh, you know? I'll eat your meatloaf.
What's that?
I'll eat your meatloaf.
Fucking thank wow. you. I've been waiting for someone to say that to me for years.
I've been waiting for Michael to say that to you.
You know, I used to think that someone would write a Meatloaf biopic and that would be my big Tina the Musical moment, or like a Bare Naked Ladies, like, it's been 1 week since you looked at me. And everybody would be like, wow, you've made it. Where did he come from?
The Divine Musical. That's what I always say to myself. Like,
Wouldn't that be really
a dream? Shakina, let's write it.
Well, I mean, we don't have to eat shit on stage literally every night, but we can do a song about it.
Make it a Snickers bar.
Yeah, it's melted a little bit first.
Yeah.
I was in Sweeney Todd way back in the day, and it was when I was on Atkins, so I just like lost 100 pounds in like a week. And I was Toby. And
you were Toby?
Yeah, because I had to eat a pie. I made them get a no carb Hot Pocket. So everybody else had a very different pie, and I was fucking eating a low carb Hot Pocket. Being like, thank you, Mom. You know, anyway.
Three times through the grinder.
Three times. No carbs in this one, love.
Three times in this microwave.
Right. Not while I'm around. Not one carbohydrate, no, sir. Anyway, I'm fun. But Shakina, I love you. Thank you for being a part of like one of the best Broadway memories that I have. Like, you to this day inspire me and make me feel loved and make me feel like it's okay to be me. I got my unruly heart tattoo, and part of that is you.
Oh,
see?
That's beautiful.
You know, like.
Oh my gosh.
Wow, I love that.
That's really beautiful.
I love that.
It's a weird thing when you're born, and just because of your birth, you are automatically political. Mm. You don't get the privilege of not being political, you know? But anyway, that's what hair to me is, and you're a rock star. And Eve, you're a rock star. And Brian, Michael, I ask you not to contact me, but anyway. I love you both. And thanks for letting me pop on real quick.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Always. Love you lots.
Bye. He flew away.
The best.
That flies away. Magical thing that ever happened.
What a treat.
Yes. Ellen loves to, Ellen, our producer, loves to surprise us with things like that. Elle Morgan picked Brooklyn from her Playbill collection. And next thing you know, at the end, Eden Espinosa pops up.
That's cool.
And I was dying.
Yeah, that's super cool.
That is very cool.
Kristen Chenoweth tonight, you know, we mentioned.
I know.
Imagine.
Pretty epic.
I did tweet Lin-Manuel about Deaf Broadway, just so you know. I mean, I don't have any pull here.
You couldn't get his lyrics right, though, with Moana, so I don't know if he's too happy with you.
I know. Yeah, I know. But I can't, any song that's like, I can't sing the notes, then I just won't sing it and I won't learn the word.
Right.
Yeah. Like, it's out of my range. I'm not going to learn those words. Sorry.
There's only so much I can fit up here. Right.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Right.
I'm already like dueling 80,000 new musicals. What do you want from me?
Shakina, we froze.
My friend, where can we find you on social media so everyone can say hi and keep in touch?
Eve?
I am at Eve C. Lindley on Instagram, and I am just at Eve Lindley on Twitter. But those are my spaces.
Thanks.
And I'm Shakines on everything. S-H-A-K-E-N-Z. Shakines.
Thank you so much. Is there anything that you want to add to just give a shout out, a call to action? Is there anything you want to add? This is for you, friends. So you could.
Anything you're working on, too?
Anything you're working on, anything you want to do, anything you want to say?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, we're in a really good place right now, but like the movement is still happening. There's a lot that you can still be doing. There's a lot of places to donate. There's a lot of things to still be doing with the Black Lives Matter movement. And I'm somebody who listens to the people who know what to do, the people who are smarter than me, and I just sort of do what they tell me to do. So, Shakina, that's you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think the most important thing we can do right now is to keep the focus, because there's going to be like more and more things going on as we get closer to November, and
Get registered to vote, everyone.
Yeah, for sure. And don't back down in your protest work. And know that, like, if you need to be safe around COVID-19, like, you don't have to be in the streets to protest. There's always numbers you can call. There's always ways to raise money from home. So everyone has a job to do in the revolution. You just got to find out what feels right for you and then do it. But please center Black trans people in your practice and in your financial giving.
Yeah.
And in your thoughts for how you're voting to these people.
Oh, sure. That
absolutely.
Need to be represented.
Now it's crunch time. Now is when we gotta, now is, yes. We, Thank you, friend.
Michael, enjoy the rest of your time in Fire Island.
I know. Thank you. Come on, Fire Island.
Have a nice time.
Thank you. And Brian, I can't wait to see you next week for... Yeah. Do we want to announce our next guest for next week?
Sure. I don't have a graphic, but...
Oh, you don't have a graphic. Never mind. It's fine.
Okay. We're going to wait.
No. Oh,
come on.
We're teasing everyone. That's what we're doing.
Okay.
You got to follow us on the gram.
Yeah. We'll tell you how Karen.
Yeah.
That's called edging, right?
Ooh. There's a lot of that on this island, if you know what I mean. So.
Until this gets too dirty.
Yeah.
Thank you guys so much.
Love you all.
Love you. Thanks for giving Eve and I a chance to hang out.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Thank you.
Thank you to Broadway Podcast Network, Alan Seals, and Dori Berenstein.
Thanks. Thank you, BPN. Mwah.
Yay.